I was invited by the people who actually started the A-10, a wonderful guy named Colonel Avery Kay, to join in to head up the technical effort to define the airplane. The Air Force called it the concept formulation package. And I did this completely outside my regular job in the Pentagon, which was working for the Secretary of Defense. We were actually doing something unique in the history of air power and air design. We were actually designing an airplane directly for the mission of supporting ground troops. That was never done before. It's never been done since then. To make an airplane do close support, the very first thing is it has to fly close enough to the targets and stay close enough that you can actually detect the kind of camouflage threats that really are dangerous to your own infantry and to your own soldiers. You just need to be in close. So you need to be flying under 300 knots. And if you happen to be lucky enough to catch a target as you see it, you need to stay real close as you come around to attack it. So you need an airplane that's very maneuverable and operates in the 200 to 300 knot region. That means a large wing in order to get that good maneuverability. You need to have beautiful visibility out of the cockpit. It means the cockpit has to be very narrow, the nose has to slope down, you have to be able to see over the side, and of course to the rear as you go past the target, and to protect yourself. You need to have weapons that will allow you to bring fire in very close to friendlies, because their most dangerous threats are the ones that are in closest. That means weapons that are very accurate and that will not harm your friends, even if they're as close as 20 meters. That almost exclusively means a powerful cannon. Hardly anything else will fill that job. And that's why the A-10 got a 30-millimeter cannon, the most powerful cannon on any airplane in the world. At the same time, you need to be able to operate under the weather. That puts even more premium on maneuverability and slow speed, because lots of places in the world, your troops are in trouble and the clouds are 1,000 feet or under. Again, fast movers, 500-knot jets, F-16s, F-15s, F-35s, not a prayer to operate under 1,000 feet. We also need an airplane that, when operating in close to these targets and under weather, can survive the obvious ground fire that it's going to get. Because if you're going after, you know, what's attacking your infantry, they're likely to shoot at you too, with rifles, machine guns, small shoulder-fired weapons. So you need an airplane that can take those kind of hits. There's no way you can do this mission and not get hit. You need an airplane that can take those hits, that will protect the pilot. We built in a titanium bathtub, about 1,200 pounds worth of armor for the pilot. Very, very thick front windshield glass to protect him. Even the side glass is bulletproof. So the pilot is protected, that's the most important thing. And the airplane has totally redundant controls. You can blow a hole in almost any part of the airplane, tear off any single control, aileron, rudder, whatever, and there's another one. We specified it had to be a second control to take over and a second mechanical control system, not hydraulic or electric that's so easily shot up, that can keep the airplane flying and get that pilot home. So we made this airplane the most survivable airplane ever built, even more so than airplanes in World War II that were very conscious of facing enemy fire and that tried to do a lot. We went way further than any airplane has ever done in requiring the airplane to be controllable after damage, have very low incidence of fire explosion. We specified that the fuel could not be anywhere near the engine. Again, that's a tremendous handicap to any fast-moving jet because they always wrap the fuel around the engine. So we forced the designers, under great complaint from them, to put no fuel anywhere near an engine. And that's why you see the configuration of the A-10 the way it came out. The engines are actually outside the fuselage. You put a rifle through a rifle bullet through a fuel tank. It's not, you know, even if the fuel comes out and burns a bit, you're not going to tear up the engine and blow up the airplane. We also specified, very important, the airplane has to be able to fly out of really austere fields, unpaved roads, dirt strips, grass fields, pastures, all that, because it's so important to be up near the troops. And if you have an airplane that can only fly out of a 10,000-foot concrete runway, you're not going to do close support. And then even more stringent, we specified the airplane had to fly out of these conditions, no hangar, no nothing, just tents and a dirt strip, and be able to to fly multiple sorties per day. The A-10 actually can fly more than three sorties a day under those conditions, come back hot, refuel and rearm, never turn off the engines, get ammunition on and go out again, because when things get hot for your friends, when they're under pressure by an overwhelming force, they just need air constantly. They need overhead air. And that's the other thing we designed into the airplane, was not only that you could put out a lot of sorties every day to keep up presence, but every sortie had to have at least 2 hours loiter time over your friendlies. If you come in there with some fast-moving jet and all you've got is 15 or 30 minutes, you're not much help, because the enemy isn't going to simply stop shooting after 15 minutes. So those were the kind of things that we designed into the A-10 that are quite unique. There's no other airplane in the world that has those combination of characteristics.